All right, good evening. Get a songbook, please, and turn to number 201. All rise. All rise, number 201, please. We'll sing on all three verses.
Oh, come, all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye, oh, come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of ages. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Sing choirs of angels, sing in exaltation. Oh, sing, all ye citizens of heaven above. Glory. Glory in the highest. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Yea, Lord, we greet thee on this happy morning, Jesus.
Merry Christmas. Great to see everybody here this evening. You may go and be seated. And we are sure excited about this evening's program. What a blessing it was to hear the younger people this morning put on the Christmas program, remind us all about that. And tonight, our teenagers will be presenting the program through song and verse and stanza and performance. So big thank you to Miss Nikki and Miss Lydia, who spent a lot of time working with them since pretty much since August. And Merry Christmas to everybody. Sit back, relax, and enjoy the program. It starts now. Thank you.
Christmas time again, and so many memories come flooding back. Problem is, when you get to be my age, those memories kind of begin to all run together. But there's one Christmas I'll never forget. Let's see. It would have been somewhere around 1949. Yes, that's it. Christmas 1949, Caldwell, New Jersey. My father had died 2 years before, and there was just me, my mom, and my two sisters. We lived in a tiny apartment not too far from the local diner where Mom worked as a waitress. Things were a whole lot different back then. Gasoline was 20 cents a gallon. A postage stamp was just 3 pennies. A loaf of bread was a whopping 14 cents. 2 quarters would pay for dinner in the next. Many workers made less than $1 an hour.
Hurry up, kids. It's time to eat. We're going to be late for church.
What's for supper, Mom? I'm starved.
Peanut butter sandwiches and beans.
Peanut butter again? I wish I lived next door with Johnny. Last night, he had 2 whole hamburgers for supper.
That sounds so good. Mom, my hair looks so awful.
Like usual.
Just sit down and eat, dear. I'll help you after supper.
Mom, can I have a glass of real milk, please?
I'm sorry, Sammy. That milk's for something special. Just get some canned milk out of the cupboard and mix it with water in the pitcher over there. It's just as good.
Just as good? You're right, Mother. I can hardly tell the difference anymore.
You could if you were normal, Becky.
It's Rebecca, you little bother.
Rebecca? Since when?
Since I've grown up. It's time for you to respect your elders, Pipsqueak.
Rebecca?
Okay, that's enough, kids. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this food, but most of all, thank you for our salvation. Now please help all of us to be kind to each other as we eat this delicious supper. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Christmas was always a pretty sparse affair at our house, but Mom did her best. Each one of us prized the small gifts that she put under the tree. Usually we'd get a tangerine, some hard candy, and maybe a toy from the Salvation Army. We didn't have much. Of course, neither did anybody else we knew. But we did have the Lord. And you know what we found out? The Lord is very good to every one of his children. Much of our lives revolved around the little church 4 blocks north of our apartment. We loved it there. The music, the preaching, the wonderful people. We used to live for Sundays and Wednesday nights. If the doors were open, wild horses couldn't keep us away. I especially remember Pastor Thomas. He was my hero.
The Lord has been mighty good to our little church this year, hasn't he? I know we may not have all the things we'd like to have, but in just the last 6 months, we've seen three families reach for the Lord. And did you know the average person seated here tonight is wealthier than 90% of the rest of the world? Yes, we're rich in a lot of ways. But most importantly, let's be thankful for the gift that was given to us almost 2,000 years ago, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I want to do something a little unusual this year. I want to take a special offering for a family in need here in Caldwell. I've already contacted the folks at the Salvation Army, and they're helping me locate the family. So since Christmas comes on a Sunday this year, let's plan on 4 weeks from today, taking an offering Sunday morning, and I'll present it to the family that afternoon. So for the next 4 weeks, let's all try to figure out what we can do without. And who knows, maybe we'll be able to reach this Lord for the reach this family for the Lord.
Oh, Mom, isn't it exciting?
Exciting?
Yeah, about raising money for the poor family.
Oh, why, yes, that's a very good idea.
I've been such a dummy, complaining all the time. Why, there's lots of people worse off than us.
That's right, Sammy, we have much to be thankful for.
So, how much are we going to give in the offering, Mom?
Well, I'm sure we could give something.
Something? Listen, you two, money doesn't grow on trees.
Kids, I'd love to help in that offering, but I really don't have enough to buy you any presents.
Don't worry, Mom. We don't want any presents.
Who doesn't?
We don't. We'd rather much see that poor family saved. Now wouldn't we, Becky?
Yeah, I guess that'd be nice.
Good. Now all we gotta do is find a way to get some extra money.
Maybe I could find some extra work somewhere.
Mom, you already work way too hard. We'll take care of this.
What could you do, baby brother?
Well, being the man of the family, I've got plans.
What kind of plans?
On the way home from church, I saw quite a few yards still covered up with leaves, and it got me thinking, shouldn't they be raked up before the snow comes?
I suppose so. Has anybody asked you?
They don't need to. I'll just rake them all up and then ask for donations.
That's not a bad idea.
Why, thank you, Miss Rebecca.
Mom, what if we used margarine instead of butter for the next 4 weeks?
And water instead of milk.
That would save a little, I suppose, if you kids don't mind.
We could have cornflakes for supper every night.
With water on them.
Yuck.
Come on, Becky. You need to lose a few pounds anyways.
Yeah, I could lose a few pounds, and his name is Sammy. Come on, Becky, please?
Well, I guess I could do some extra babysitting.
And I can help you.
I knew you'd come through, big sister.
Come to think of it, I heard Miss Brooks hasn't been able to clean her house since she had that fall 2 weeks ago.
I bet she'd be glad to have my help, Mom.
She just might, Katie.
She'd probably pay you, too.
Mom, do you remember that delicious fudge you used to make?
I sure do. It was my grandmother's recipe.
Why don't you make it anymore, Mom?
Well, it's awfully expensive with all that chocolate and butter.
Well, why don't we see if Mr. Harris down at the A&P will give us enough credit to buy all the ingredients? We'll sell the fudge door to door and pay him back in no time.
That's a great idea.
Why, thank you.
I volunteer to lick the pan, sir.
This just might work.
That wasn't the end of
As the days passed, our excitement grew. We lived on beans, cornflakes, peanut butter, and bologna, but we loved it. We were on a mission, and no sacrifice was too great.
Let's get down to the cookie jar and see how much money we've made so far.
You kids are going to wear that money out if you keep counting it so much.
I've got some more, Mom. Mr. Miller gave me a whole $1 William for raking his lawn this afternoon.
Why are you calling it a $1 William?
I'm not familiar enough with it to call it a $1 bill.
Sammy, I'm gonna burn that joke book of yours. Look at this. Miss Brooks gave me 50 cents for helping her clean her house this afternoon.
That's wonderful, kids. What about you, Becky?
Oh, you wouldn't be interested.
Come on, Becky. Did you get paid today?
I can't seem to remember. Becky?
Oh, yes. Now I recall. Miss Smith paid me for all that babysitting I did last week.
Check this out. One Lincoln and three Georges.
$8?
She must really appreciate you, Becky.
Oh, it's nothing for someone as mature as I am.
Oh, wow, I can't believe it. $8.
You haven't even heard the best part yet.
There's more?
I gave Miss Smith a taste of your fudge, Mom, and she asked if we could make two batches for her garden club party tomorrow night.
But I haven't got time, Becky. I've got to be at the diner in 30 minutes.
Don't worry, Mom. I'll handle this. The best cooks in the world are men, you know.
Oh, brother.
Now, I'll just turn on the stove right over here.
That's the clock, Sammy.
Yeah, I knew that. Everybody knows that this is the stove control right over here.
That's the oven, sweetie.
I've got an idea, Mom. Why don't you explain exactly how to make the fudge to all of us, and me and Katie can be Sammy's, helpers. What do you think, Sammy?
I suppose you guys could do some of the easy stuff, like washing dishes and cleaning up.
Why, thank you, Your Majesty.
What are we gonna call it?
Call what?
The fudge.
How about something real novel, like fudge? It's worked so far.
No, that's way too plain. If this stuff is really gonna go, it's gotta sound special.
Mom, didn't you say it was your grandmother's recipe?
That's right, Katie.
How about you call it Grandma's Fudge?
That's better, but it still needs more pizzazz.
This is ridiculous.
Okay. How about Grandma's Famous Fudge?
Now you're talking, Katie. You're a marketing genius.
And so it was born, Grandma's Famous Fudge. Mom gave us a 20-minute lesson in fudge making and then hurried out the door to work. By the time she returned home, we had burnt fudge all over the kitchen and we kids were all mad at each other. But with Mom's help, before the night was over, we had two perfect batches of Grandma's Famous Fudge. First thing the next morning, I proudly delivered our pride and joy to Miss Smith. Not only did Miss Smith love our fudge, but every woman in her garden club raved about it too. Before we knew it, we had orders coming out our ears. It seemed like every one of those women had a Christmas party that wouldn't be complete without Grandma's Famous Fudge. We were having the time of our lives working around the clock. That needy family wasn't going to be poor anymore. The wealth of 1,000 kingdoms was piling up in our cookie jar.
Thanks for supper, Mom. It was really good.
You're welcome, Sammy. I worked long and hard on those cornflakes.
They were really good, Mom.
I can't believe I let you kids talk me into giving you cornflakes instead of meatloaf on Christmas Eve.
But it's our last chance to save for the offering tomorrow, Mom.
I know, but you kids deserve something special once in a while, too.
Dinner was really special, Mom. I can't remember the last time I had real milk on my cornflakes. Thank you.
You kids beat all. I'm so proud of you.
I'm so excited. I don't think I'll be able to sleep tonight.
Let's count the money again.
I'll get the cookie jar. It's empty.
Empty?
The money's gone.
I knew this would happen. Call the police.
Call the army.
Wait, kids, settle down.
Settle down? But we've been robbed.
I know who took the money.
Who? Let me at him.
I took it.
You?
Yes, I stopped by the bank this afternoon and got some larger bills for all the change.
Oh, Mom, don't scare us like that.
I almost had a heart attack.
I did have a heart attack.
I'm sorry, Sammy. I hope there's no permanent damage.
Oh, get up off the floor, Sammy, before I give you some real permanent damage.
So, Becky, you need a sense of humor.
And you just need some sense.
So, where's the money?
Right here in my purse. All $122 of it.
Oh, Mom, is that what I think it is?
$100 bill.
Oh, wow, $100 bill. It doesn't look real.
It's real, all right.
Can I hold it, Mom?
Sure, Sammy, here.
I feel like a millionaire.
Let me hold it, Sammy.
Hold your horses, Katie. That needy family is gonna faint when they see this.
I can't wait till Pastor Thomas takes the offering tomorrow.
Kids, are you sure you want to give all this money in the offering?
Of course, Mom.
Why not?
Because I feel like a terrible mother. It's Christmas Eve, and none of you have any presents, not even one.
That's what we've been planning all along.
I know, but I still feel guilty. Your father would have made sure you had at least gotten something. And wouldn't it hurt to take a little bit of this money, go down to the Salvation Army, and get you kids something?
We can't do that, Mom.
What about your shoes, Sammy? Those holes aren't getting any smaller.
I'll just cut out new pieces of cardboard and put them inside them like I always do. They're fine.
And Becky, you can't even button your winter coat. It's so small.
It's okay, Mom. I always got too hot when I buttoned it up anyways.
And Katie, wouldn't you like a new toy?
I suppose so, Mom. But not as much as I would like to see that poor family saved.
I've got to hand it to you, kids. Your father would be so proud of you.
Can I put this in the offering plate tomorrow, Mom?
I don't know, Sammy. You're going to have to ask your sisters about that one.
It's fine with me.
Becky?
Well, I guess it'd be okay.
All right.
But how are we going to divide up the rest?
Well, Mom, you ought to put in the $20, and Becky and I can each give in a dollar.
Just $1?
Kids, it doesn't matter who puts the money in the offering plate. You've all worked very hard for this, and the Lord is going to reward each one of you.
I didn't sleep a wink that night. We got to church early Christmas morning and sat right down front so we could be the first ones to give. Some of the other kids looked at us rather strangely since we were all wearing the same clothes we'd been wearing all year long, but I didn't care. I had more money in my hand than they had ever dreamed about. The service seemed to drag on forever. But then finally, the big moment arrived. As long as I live, I'll never forget the thrill of dropping that $100 bill into the offering plate. My eyes filled with tears. I was the happiest, richest kid on earth. Just like the wise men, I had given my very best to the Lord.
What's for Christmas dinner, Mom?
You'll never believe it. The A&P had a Christmas special yesterday, and guess what I found on sale?
What?
A giant box of cornflakes.
Cornflakes.
Yes, Sammy, and they also had a special buy on oatmeal.
Oh, goody, my favorite.
Mom, why don't we raise some more money and give it to another needy family on New Year's?
Sure. People will need money for their New Year's party, won't they?
No more fudge, please.
Sorry, guys. Nobody's making any fudge today.
Thank goodness.
Why not, Mom?
Because I'm using the oven.
For what?
Yesterday, I also found something else on sale.
What?
A half-price turkey.
Oh, turkey sounds so delicious.
How about cranberry sauce?
And mashed potatoes?
And dressing?
And all the trimmings. We're going to eat like the richest folks in town today.
I wonder if Pastor Thomas has seen the poor family yet.
He could be giving them our money right now.
We better hurry up and pray so that they'll get saved.
That's a good idea, Sammy. Why don't you go ahead and lead us?
Dear Jesus, you've given us so much. Thank you for the best Christmas of all. I especially pray for Pastor Thomas as he delivers the money to the poor family so they'll get saved and...
I wonder who that could be.
I'll get it. Pastor Thomas, come on in. We were just praying for you. Have you delivered the money yet?
Not quite yet, actually. I met with the folks at the Salvation Army and I talked with the deacons, and the vote was unanimous.
What vote? What are you talking about?
The deacons and the Ladies Missionary Society all agreed that...
Agreed on what?
They agreed that the special church offering should be given to you and your family.
To us? But Pastor...
No. Here, it's settled. God bless you and have a Merry Christmas.
Who was it, Mom?
Who was at the door?
Pastor Thomas.
Pastor Thomas? What did he say? Did he deliver the money yet?
Did the needy family get saved?
He gave me this.
What is it?
It's the offering, honey. The church decided to give it to us.
But it was supposed to go to the poor family.
The poorest family in town.
Guess that's us, Katie.
We are poor.
The whole church says we are.
I just want to cry. What are my friends going to say?
Great. This morning I was a millionaire, and now I'm a beggar. Merry Christmas.
Bah humbug. Why don't we go out onto the street corner and beg for food like the rest of the bums?
Kids, the Lord is in control of this. It's not as bad as it seems.
No, it's worse. I'm never going back to that church again.
Becky, don't talk like that. Remember when Jesus came to earth? He was humiliated too.
But I don't want to be humiliated, and I'm not touching that money.
What are we going to do with it, Mom?
I don't know, Sammy. Why don't we ask God to show us?
Even though we prayed that day, we still felt terrible. To make matters worse, I counted the money, and it came to $141. We had given all of it except for $19. As far as I was concerned, I never wanted to set foot in that church again. But the next Sunday was New Year's Day, and Mom forced us to go, much to her regret.
I'm never going back to that dumb church again.
You don't need to worry about that, slugger. They'll lock the doors out before they see you coming.
Sammy, why did you hit David?
Because he called me a beggar.
So?
So I showed him who the real beggar was.
And what is that supposed to mean?
When I got through beating him up, he was down on his knees begging for mercy.
Pastor Thomas was really upset. He said David's nose was bleeding everywhere.
It was really neat, Mom. Blood was all over the carpet.
Great. My brother's not only a beggar, he's a juvenile delinquent.
Kids, I'm having a hard time with this too, but we've got to hang on to the truth. In Christ, we are rich, not poor. We are rich.
Tell that to the whole church, Mom.
Sammy, you be quiet. We are not beggars, no matter what anybody says.
Sorry, Mom.
Just please don't make us go back to that church again.
If only your father were here. He'd know what to do.
It's okay, Mom. Don't cry.
Lord, help me get through this. What am I supposed to do?
Families all around us are crumbling every day, yielding to the enemy and throwing life away. truth. When the struggle seems too great, Lord, keep our eyes on you. Lord, bless our home, protect our home. Let it be a refuge in this world of sin. Lord, reign within. Keep our tongue and true, and when we need you most, Lord, draw us close, connected to each other. Lord, bless our home, we give our home to you. Thank you for your goodness. Our love was in your plan. Help us free the future, always trusting in your hand. Keep us warm and tender. Keep us clean and pure. Drive us to each other's arms and make our love endure. Lord, bless our home, protect our home. Let it be a refuge in this world of sin. Lord, reign within. Keep us strong and true. And when we need you most, Lord, draw us close, committed to each other. Lord, bless our home. We give our home to you.
The following week was awfully difficult. Although we kids tried to be strong, Mom still cried a lot. We hadn't seen her so low since Dad's funeral. I was mad at everybody, but I was especially mad at God. Why was he allowing my mom to suffer so much? The following Sunday, Mom decided we'd try to go to church one more time, and none of us were about to tell her no. There was a missionary there that Sunday named Dallas Washer. He was a missionary from Togo, West Africa. His exciting stories about serving the Lord in a very difficult place helped us to forget about our own problems, at least for a little while.
In the rainforests of Africa, Sunday morning services are a lot different than they are here. For instance, just 2 months ago at our church plant in Koje, it started pouring the rain. And since we have a grass roof, leaks started appearing here and there, and people began shifting about to keep from getting wet. And to make matters even worse, a large poisonous snake fell from the ceiling, and people began jumping out windows. It was then and there I decided to put a metal roof on our church in Koje. The project would cost about $150, which is a lot of money for the poverty-stricken Africans. I pray that the Lord will burden on your heart to give to our cause, and the need is great, but I know our God is able.
Before we close the service, I'd like to take a special offering for Brother Washer. Now I know asking for an offering 2 weeks after Christmas isn't exactly the best timing, but these people in Africa have a real need. Let's all try to give something.
I think the idea hit us all at the same time. We looked at Mom, who was smiling for the first time since Christmas. As soon as we got home, we started talking a mile a minute.
Sammy, are you thinking what I'm thinking?
I am, if you're thinking what I'm thinking.
I think we're all thinking the same thing.
Will somebody please just say it? We need to give our money to the missionary.
How much do you guys want to give?
All of it. Of course, there's not any question.
That might not be enough.
How are we going to get it to him?
We can take it to the Miller's house.
Why would we take it there?
Because that's where he spent the night. He's not leaving till after lunch.
How do you know that, Sammy?
Simple. I asked the pastor.
You're a genius, baby brother.
Why, thank you, Your Highness.
I grabbed the money envelope that had been sitting untouched on the kitchen table for 2 weeks. We immediately set out again. It was a long walk, but we finally got to the Miller's house just as Mr. Washer was putting his suitcase in the car.
Sir? My family and I would like to have a word with you.
With me? I'm sorry, I don't live here. I'm just visiting.
We know that, sir, but we still need your help.
Well, I haven't got much money, but I'll do what I can.
Oh, mister, we don't want your money. We were hoping you could help us get rid of some money here in that envelope.
Well, are you kids in some kind of trouble?
We sure are.
We already tried to get rid of it once, but it didn't work.
Well, where did the money come from?
All over town.
We've had to do all kinds of things to get it, too.
Yeah, sometimes we had to stop people right on the street.
Oh, really?
You kids sure set a mean pace. Have you given Mr. Washer the money yet?
We're trying to, Mom.
How did you know my name, ma'am?
We heard you in church this morning.
You were really great.
Especially the part about the big snake.
Oh, now this is making sense.
How much did you get in the offering this
morning? Sammy.
No, it's all right, ma'am. We got about $11, son.
That's all?
Well, every little bit helps. In God's time, we'll get that new roof. You'll see.
Well, we don't want you to have to wait too long.
Will you take our offering now and add it to the offering? We didn't have it with us this morning.
Well, are you sure this isn't money that you need for your family?
Mister, don't you worry about us. We're really, really rich, and there's lots more where that came from.
Sammy.
Well,
it's true, Mom.
What are your names?
Oh, we'd rather not say. Please don't tell anybody who gave you this.
Just remember us as the richest family in town.
Thank you all very much.
Sammy, what's that stuff in your pockets?
I almost forgot. It's for Mr. Washer to take with him to Africa.
What is it?
Well, it used to be fudge.
We were a different family after that. I think we floated all the way home, singing and laughing and thanking the Lord for his goodness. Much to our surprise, we began getting more requests for Grandma's famous fudge. And before long, we had quite a little family business going. Then one Sunday night, several months later, we got another surprise.
Tonight, for our missionary report, I'd like to read a letter I just received on Friday. Dear friends, I've enclosed a picture of our church in Koje. Thanks to you, we now have a brand new snake-proof metal roof. We had our first service in our new building last Sunday. Even though it was raining, 8 people got saved at the end of the service. Let me add a special word of thanks to one of your families who went the extra mile to help with this project. They only identified themselves as the richest family in town. Thank you, folks. I appreciate your unusual sacrifice. Yours for souls, Dallas Washer. Well, I think that Brother Washer might have got us mixed up with one of his other supporting churches, but nonetheless, thank you all for giving.
Ever since that night, all those years ago, I've realized that I'm a member of the wealthiest family in the universe. My father owns it all. We still had some hard times, plenty of them, but the Lord always provided. I even made it through 4 years of Bible college, and you'll never guess who paid my way. Grandma. Well, at least Grandma's Famous Fudge. And today I'm president of Grandma's Famous Fudge Factory. Over the years, I suppose, we've made a lot of money, but we never held on to much of it. However, we have built several churches and supported hundreds of missionaries around the world. You see, it never made much sense to me to keep a bunch of money down here when we could send it on ahead up there. Now think about it. 1,000 years from now, it's not going to matter a hill of beans what kind of clothes I'm wearing or how much money I have in the bank. All that's going to matter is my relationship with Jesus Christ, the greatest treasure of all.
A thousand kingdoms has come in a baby.
All right, now before we finish up all this, we just wanted to say a few thank yous to the people who should have strangled us a few times, and it definitely had the opportunity to. But first, we want to thank Miss Lydia for all she did for us on the piano and everything. Thank you so much, Miss Lydia. And then secondly, Miss Nikki, thank you so much for all you did for us. There were definitely times she should have smacked any of us in the face, but she stayed strong and she was good. But thank you so much.
He's not wrong. Had you guys seen dress rehearsal Thursday night or the practices this afternoon, all three of them, I was like, well, it is what it is. But the Lord blesses it every year. And I cried down there. I'm done. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to work with your children. I love them all very much. And I'm very proud of all of them. And you should be too. Thank you.
Did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you've delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know your baby boy would calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you've kissed your little baby, you've kissed the face of God. The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? This sleeping child you're holding is the great I Am.
A big thank you again, Miss Nikki, Miss Lydia. Appreciate it so much. And they always do a great job. Luke chapter 2, verse 11. I just want to give you a quick little thought on Christmas love, or I almost titled this the equation of Luke 2:11, the equation of Luke 2:11. Luke chapter 2, verse 11 is an interesting verse because of some of the things that it brings to our attention, and I want to just share that with you for a few minutes. Thank you, Brother Coons. Thank you, Laney. And thank you, Miss Nikki. Great job, young people. It's been a blessing to be at a church. Let me just say real quickly as we get in this message how thankful I am. A lot of churches in this country would die to have the youth numbers that we have in this church. This morning, the young ones that are coming up, I remember when many of these kids that you just saw up here performing were in the morning service. In fact, many of them were in the two-year-old saying moo years ago, and now they're teens. And then I look out in this crowd, and there's some that used to be on this platform, and now they're sitting out there, and they're adults. And just thankful for the youth God's given to our church, and can be steadfast in praying for them, and the devil's after them, and we want to pray for them. Luke chapter 2, verse 11 is an amazing verse. It's probably the most famous verse this time of year. And it says, and the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, you bring good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all. I'm sorry, that's verse 10, verse 11. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. I was thinking about the word equation and how they have, to be qualified for a particular job, there's certain things you have to have in your resume. Number one, usually a lot of times you have to have some kind of a college degree for lots of jobs. Number two, a lot of times they like to see experience. And number three, they want some good references. I've actually made references for people through the years. It's about the only time as a pastor I have to lie. But anyway, sorry, some of you will catch that by slow freight. But if you get all three of those parts, then it equals qualified. It equals qualified. But the answer to this equation, or the end result, or the solution to this particular equation is the final destination is John 3:16. Because from Genesis chapter 3 to John chapter 3, there was a great need. Somebody had to fulfill the obligations or responsibilities to make it so that you could say equals John 3:16. For example, if you want to get to 9, 3 plus 3 plus 3 equals 9. If you only have 3 plus 3 and not that third 3, then you're not getting to your destination of 9. And if you look at Luke chapter 2, verse 11, you see three things that are specifically said about Christ. It says Savior, it says Christ, and it says Lord. Only one man ever born in the history of mankind fulfilled that equation. Nobody else has ever been Savior, Christ, and Lord at the same time. A lot of men have thought they were lords. They thought they had power. A lot of men thought they were some kind of a Christ. In fact, Jesus warns us in the book of Matthew about false Christs. And then some people think they're the Savior or a martyr of their cause. But nobody has been all three of them at the same time. Which means nobody ever born would ever get us to that destination verse, which really, if you think about it, John 3:16 is a great Christmas verse. For God so loved the world that he gave. Gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And so tonight, when you think about it, Christmas is all about love. You see, for Jesus Christ to come and be the Savior, the Christ, and the Lord. You see, a Savior defined as a deliverer, and He is our deliverer today. He's our deliverer from death, hell, sin, the devil, and so on. As Christ, He is the Messiah, the anointed one, the promised one. And as Lord, He is supreme in authority. And remember, He's not just Lord. According to Philippians chapter 2, He is Lord of lords. Which means if you put those three things together, Savior, Christ, and Lord, and you put all those three plus three equals, you're going to get that final answer. The equation is complete because of Jesus Christ. He is the perfect answer. He is the solution to all mankind. He is the final product. He is John 3:16. He is the whole Bible. He's the Word in flesh. He's the gift from heaven. He's the Savior of our soul. He's the Christ of all mankind. And He's the Lord of all lords. And so today when you look at Luke chapter 2 verse 11, and you begin to wonder if we'll ever get to that answer, that equal side. On the other side of that equals equation of John 3:16, the answer is yes, we'll get there. And we did get there, and we're able to get there because Jesus is Savior, Jesus is Christ, and Jesus is Lord. So tonight, maybe it should become more of a tradition at Christmas that we don't just quote from Luke 2, and obviously Luke 2 is more popular. Sometimes people go to Matthew 2 also, but Luke chapter 2, and we love Luke 2. Boy, we've heard a lot about Luke 2, and probably, I'm sorry, just one more message Wednesday night on Luke 2 probably, okay, and then we'll move on, all right, and get ready for the new year. But maybe John 3 ought to be thrown in there, because John 3 is on the other side of that equal. Because of Jesus, who's the Christ, the Savior, and the Lord, all three, we have John 3:16, and let me say it again for you, quote for you again, and make us extra grateful this time here. For God so loved. Watch Brielle interpret it. For God so loved. For God so loved. It's an immeasurable love. That's the beauty of the English language there. The translators put that simple one syllable, two-letter word, so, meaning it's immeasurable. It's a love that can't be measured. So much so that, watch this, look at the sign for it again. For God so, and keep spreading those arms. Spreading those arms, boom, until He finally lays Him out on a cross. It went from a wooden manger to a wooden cross because He was Christ, Savior, and Lord. Boy, I'm so glad when you add Christ, Savior, and Lord together on one side of the equation. It equals out to, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Thank you for listening so well. Hello, Pastor Randy Dignan here of Bible Baptist Church in Jefferson City, Missouri. I'm going to take a moment and express to you what our main vision and purpose is of this ministry. You see, much of this world today has a question. It's a question that was asked in John chapter 3 by one person. It's a question that is asked by the masses, but when you really think about it, it's really a question we all have to come to grips with, face to face with, one-on-one in our lives, sometime in our life. The question is this: where will I spend eternity? And that question was asked by a religious leader by the name of Nicodemus in John chapter 3. He approached Jesus Christ in the middle of the night and had a question about spiritual matters. Well, good thing for Nicodemus, he came to the right person at the right time because Jesus Christ is the answer in spiritual matters. You see, many of us have questions about that, and man has tried in many of its efforts to answer that question with their own ideas and philosophies. We've tried to come up with ideas on how to get us to heaven, how to confirm our way to heaven. But the fact is, we got to find out what God says about eternal things. And that's why asking Jesus Christ that question is so vital, because when you ask Jesus a question, you get the answer. And as the question was asked, Jesus answered simply this: ye must be born again. In John chapter 3, that's what He said to Nicodemus, and that's the same thing He says to you and to me, even today. You see, God is God of this universe, but He's not everybody's Father. What does that have to do with John chapter 3? Well, think about this. We all have birthdays. We all are physically born onto this physical planet, or else you wouldn't be able to watch me, or I wouldn't be able to sign to you right now or talk to you at this time. But God, being a spiritual being, knew that though our bodies are temporal, our spiritual part of us, our spiritual anatomy of us, is an eternal thing. And so God says, I'm more concerned about the spiritual issues. So that's why He sent His Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for you and me 2,000 years ago and live again 3 days later so that you and I can have a spiritual birthday and know for sure that heaven is our home. Well, that leads to the next question. Why do we need a spiritual birthday? Well, it's simple. We're all sinners. We've all broken God's law and God's commands. But God loves us so much so that he let Jesus Christ become the substitute for your sin and my sin. So that if we recognize and admit that we are sinners, we can then trust in Jesus Christ as our substitute, and more so than that, our personal Savior, and know that on top of our physical birthdays, we have a spiritual birthday now, in that God becomes our Father, we become his sons, daughters, we become his children, and we know we're going to go to heaven someday. My friend, it's very simple. It's not about what the church says, what I have ideas about, or what you have ideas about. It's finding out what God says directly to you and me. And he did it right there in the Bible, and in particular, John chapter 3, when Jesus says, "Ye must be born again." If our church can help you with that question, if you have any questions about that, we can give you some answers. We'd be glad to help you in any way we can. Again, Pastor Randy, personally thanking you for watching the message. And again, if there's anything we can do for you, let us know. God bless, and make it a great day.